Ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen and ladies and gents, some of you are having some problems with foreclosure, bankruptcies, and so forth. Those of you who are having problems with foreclosure, the very moment that you are faced with foreclosure and you receive that notice of unlawful detainer, you should do a notice of notice of removal. As a matter of fact, I would actually call it a notice of automatic removal. Why should you do this? We're going to do the best we can to explain this to you so that you can understand it on a basic level. This is an article which talks about bankruptcy jurisdiction. Now, what I want you to understand is, why is it that bankruptcy is only heard on the federal level? Why? Oh, and look at this. I want you to pay attention because I didn't write this. The court to manage the bankrupt estate. Bankruptcy courts are always about estates, people. But we're gonna get to that in a second, okay? Like I said, I haven't read this article, but you'll see in a minute how it all applies. As I explained to you, this is not a matter of me guessing. This is a matter of me knowing in advance and being able to go online like I'm doing this morning and know that the facts are there. So let me tell you what I did originally. There is an article. Find my mouse because I can't see it. Okay, just want to make sure my Adobe is finally downloaded. It took so long. Here we go. This is what I wrote because I was, and I just added this to this article. Got Luther in the background singing about how much he knows somebody wants to.
The in-house legal professional guide to.
Let's see what it's a professional guide to.
Removing cases to federal court. A checklist.
Okay, I've had several people send me this, but I've already had this particular article. And what I did is, like I told you guys, I was going to help somebody with his appeal. But the individual failed to take care of his obligation. I did my part, but the individual failed to take care of his part. And when I called him yesterday, all I got was excuses. And he will say, well, no, I wasn't giving you an excuse. And I will say, whatever. Okay? And you have no idea how much I wanted to argue his case. To bring it before the... Let's move that back up. To bring it before the appeals court. This argument. I know that if I had brought this argument, I could have been successful. Because I would have done a certiorari before the United States Supreme Court on this issue to have addressed it for everybody. But alas, it was not meant to be. So let me show you what I put in here thus far to let you know that before I even pulled that article up, it is because of this line of thinking is the reason why I pulled the article up. Okay? I want you all to pay attention to what's said here. Most of this is just pulled up from the web. As you would know, the moment you did the search, you would pull up. See, you guys can see the mouse, but I can't because it's a line. Okay? It's a very thin line between love and hate. All right. What I pulled up is this. Let me show it to you, and then we're going to come back to that. But we're going to go back. Back, 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 back. It's Round and Round by Tevin Campbell. I believe this song was written by Mr. Prince himself. Round and round and round. Ooh, yeah. See, original jurisdiction in bankruptcy is what I looked up. And the first thing I pulled up is
the United States Bankruptcy Court are courts created under Article 1 of the United States Constitution. The federal district courts have original and exclusive jurisdiction over all cases arising under the bankruptcy code, and bankruptcy cases cannot be filed in state court.
Excuse me? Ladies and gentlemen, why can't you file bankruptcy in state court? Does not the 10th Amendment give states the right to do certain things? So why is it that states can't have bankruptcy cases? Because it's all about estates, people. It's all about that constructive trust thing going on. Well, this is not a video about that. This is just letting you know that's the reason why it states that. But this is in Wikipedia. Wikipedia. Sorry. I say Wikipedia, as I've mentioned in several videos. It's because they allow any idiot to put their opinion in Wikipedia. However, when Wikipedia has things like this, oh, by the way, I'll give Wikipedia some credit. Over the past 8 years, it has been a little bit more careful about the contributions of individuals to Wikipedia. Okay, so it has been trying to clean up its
original act, okay?
Where we want to, but the world still goes around and round.
By the way, Prince is in the background of this song. All right, ladies and gentlemen,
the United States bankruptcy courts created under Article 1 of the United States Constitution. The federal district courts have original jurisdiction over all cases arising under the bankruptcy code, and bankruptcy cases cannot be filed in state court.
Okay, now in the second one, as you saw, one day I'll make it in the big city because I'll be looking for a girl who's pretty. One day I'll make a play and she will say okay because I plan to be a cool kitty. All right. Let's do this. Title 28, United States Code, subsection. If you didn't know what this symbol stood for, it stands for subsection. S over S, subsection 1334. Bankruptcy cases and proceedings.
The district court shall have original and exclusive jurisdiction of all cases under Title 11.
Now wait. Hold on. I need you all to understand what's going on here. There is about to be a contradiction. Okay? And the basic principles of statutory interpretation, for which there are nine, says that the next paragraph, if it contradicts the first, can be ignored.
Except as provided in section E2, and notwithstanding any act of Congress that confers exclusive jurisdiction on a court or courts other than the district courts. The district court shall have original but not exclusive jurisdiction of all civil proceedings arising under Chapter 11 or Title 11, or arising or related to cases under Title 11.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a lie. Do you know why? Because the district court, which is, they call them Article 3 courts, because Article 3 was established and annotated in the original Judiciary Act of September 24th, 1789. Let's pay attention to this right here. Bankruptcy courts are Article 1 courts. The district courts are Article 3 courts, which is why they have original and exclusive jurisdiction, which makes this because Congress cannot confer exclusive jurisdiction on a court or courts other than a district court because it doesn't have the authority, separation of powers. Congress cannot delegate its power to the judicial branch. That is why bankruptcy courts are Article 1 courts or administrative courts. Okay, we'll explain that in a minute so you'll better understand that. Okay, but understand, bankruptcy courts are Article 1 courts. Article 1 courts are congressional courts or legislative courts or... basically, let's just say legislative courts. Oh, y'all know this girl right here, Stephanie? That's I Can't Let Go, y'all. That's my girl. Okay, let's continue. even, this is me talking now, even if Congress could authorize state courts to hear matters involving non-judicial foreclosure act, the Fair Debt Collection Procedures Act, the Federal Housing Act, the Mortgage Satisfaction Act, and I should put, etc., all, I just can't let her go. Anyway, it has no authority by the Constitution to violate the 9th and 10th Amendment rights of American citizens. What am I saying here? Does anybody know what the 9th Amendment right is? Does anybody know what the 10th Amendment right is? I.e., their right to choose jurisdiction. Now wait, how does the 9th and 10th Amendment talks about a person's right to choose jurisdiction? Well, let's do this. We'll just pull up, yeah, let's do just 9th and 10th. 9th, and, Sorry, thinking too fast, got a headache this morning, don't know why. It is probably because I didn't sleep very well. Let her go. Can't let her go, y'all. All right. I want all of you to please understand what's going on here. We're going to click on Wikipedia. And while we're clicking on Wikipedia, we're going to click over to the next window, which is already, well, it looked like it had already pulled up.
9th and 10th Amendment of the United States.
Yeah, I put amendments without the M
because I clicked on it and it just, I didn't hit it hard enough.
Okay, I want you guys to pay attention to the 9th Amendment. It's right here in front of us. Pay attention. The enumeration of the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people. You have the right to redress, people. Congress does not have the right to take that away from you. Okay, this amendment
means nothing.
Means that nothing written in the Constitution can be used to conceal amendments to it. Huh? That's not what that means. Who wrote that? Oh, God. Congress for kids. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Hey, y'all know this guy, Anthony Hamilton? Y'all know Anthony Hamilton? Well, this is, do you feel me? Do y'all feel me? Okay, anyway, let's go to the 9th and 10th Amendments so that you guys can see. I do not want to go to Cura. We can go to Wikipedia. Do you feel me? Because they can't get it that wrong, huh? Tell me if I'm getting through to you. Do you feel me? Now, I want you to understand this so that you get it. The United States bankruptcy courts are courts created in Article 1 of the United States Constitution. Let's pull up the case law.
United States courts, basics.
I don't like that right there, y'all. I don't think that's it. Well, anyway, the current system of bankruptcy court was created by the United States Congress in 1978, effective April 4th, 1984. The United States Bankruptcy Court functions as units of the district court. No, they don't. Because district court is supposed to be Article 3 and have subject matter jurisdiction over bankruptcy courts. The district courts have original and exclusive jurisdiction over all cases arising under the bankruptcy code. And bankruptcy cases cannot be filed in state court. Each of the 94 federal judicial districts handling bankruptcy matters. Okay? Handles bankruptcy matters. Okay, pay attention. I want you guys to understand this. Article 1 courts. Let's find out what an Article 1 court is. If it's going to let me go to this hyperlink. Excuse me, I'm stretching because I gotta stretch. Do you feel me, babe? But now while we're doing that, let's get to the Ninth Amendment, because that's also what I'm supposed to be explaining to you guys so that you get it. Now, again, some people, this information is very vital. But even if you don't think that this information is helpful, this information is helpful. Sorry, they do this little drive every single year. I don't want to help you. I'm not going to help you. You don't deserve no help. All right, Ninth Amendment.
To the United States Constitution addresses rights retained by the people that are not specifically enumerated in the Constitution.
It is part of the Bill of Rights. Okay? Now let's do this. Let's read the actual text, because that's all I'm interested in, right?
It says the enumeration of the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people.
Okay? Just that simple. So these are the facts. Congress does not have the right to take away a right. Now, why did I put the Ninth Amendment? Because you have the right to redress, including something such as bankruptcy, somebody coming and trying to take your property. But you got to stay within the laws and the frameworks and blah, blah, blah. Ladies and gentlemen, wait. When the Constitution was put to the states for ratification after being signed on September 17, 1787. Ladies and gentlemen, remember I told you about September 24th, 1789? It was 2 years later that they came up with the
Article 1, 3, 4
courts. The Judiciary Act. Now pay attention.
The Anti-Federalists argued that the Bill of Rights should be added.
One of the arguments that the Federalists gave against the adding of the Bill of Rights during the debates about ratification of the Constitution was that a listing of rights could problematically enlarge the powers specified in Article 1, Section 8 of the new Constitution by implication. For example, the Federalist
84
Alexander Hamilton asked, "Why declare that things shall not be done which there is no power to do?"
Likewise, James Madison explained to Thomas Jefferson,
"I concede that in a certain degree, the rights in question are reserved by a manner in which the federal powers are granted, by Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution."
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this is all bullcrap. We don't need to know this. We don't need to understand it at all. It just means that you retain rights. Look,
rights retained by the people.
So you retain rights, not reserve them. You retain your rights. Okay? You're exercising the Ninth Amendment. That's why I put the Ninth Amendment. Now, let's go to the Tenth Amendment. That's only the ninth. Wait, hold on. There's an easier way to get there. Let's go up a little bit. Right there. It's just a radio, y'all. It's just a radio. Because I want you to know, don't you remember you told me you loved me, baby? You said you'll be coming back this way again, baby. Baby, 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 baby. Oh, baby. You know what I do? I love you. I really do. I really do. This is called Superstar, ladies and gentlemen. This is my favorite part of this song. My favorite part of this song. Tell him, Luther. You look for me to be yours. You want my love, but then you're at my door. Don't you remember me anymore? Loneliness. That's my song, people. All right, sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. But, you know, we got to go there because these videos are long.
and it's a lot of information.
So let's do this. The 10th Amendment of the United States Constitution.
It is actually the United States of America Constitution. Go ahead and look at the Constitution. But anyway, we the people of the United States. Okay, so whatever. The 10th Amendment,
Amendment number 10,
of the United States Constitution, which is part of the Bill of Rights, was ratified December 15th.
Hey, a day before my birthday!
1791.
Wait a minute. The 10th Amendment came in after the 9th Amendment, which was
ratified
September 17th, 1787. And then the Judiciary Act comes in, and then the 10th Amendment comes in. What does the 10th Amendment says?
Well, it expresses the principle of federalism and states' rights, which strictly supports the entire plan of the original Constitution for the United States of America.
See? The United States of America!
By stating that the federal government possesses only those powers delegated to it by the United States Constitution, after remaining powers are reserved for the states or the people. Look at that.
Let's go, see, Congress 1789. The amendment was proposed by Congress in 1789. Why?
During the writing of the Judiciary Act.
September 24th,
1789.
That very first Congress. It was the first Congress, not the last Congress, not the third Congress, not the fifth Congress. Let's read the text of the 10th Amendment.
The powers delegated are not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states,
are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. Not respectively, but to the people. You have rights, people. That was the case of, watch this,
BONDVUS 2012.
When are you gonna say it's alright, it's alright? Ooh, baby, it's alright.
That's Luther!
Alright, yeah. Look, ladies and gentlemen, Bond versus the United States. She worked as a chemical manufacturer, well, in a chemical plant.
And I'm sorry, it is kind of funny. See, she learned that her friend Marlinda Haynes was pregnant with her husband's baby.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody's sleeping in my bed. And so what she did is she went and she grabbed some chemicals and she decided to chemicalize the woman's face. Because, you know, women kind of take things like that. And so Mrs. Bond, Carol, hey, Carol Ann. Mrs. Bond was prosecuted by the federal government in 2010. Or was it 2009? I forgot what day it was, y'all. But I do know that she filed an appeal. And what happened is the Supreme Court said in 2011 that Bond, who said that her 10th Amendment rights were violated. Now, I told people then, I tell you now, Bond had the help of a jailhouse lawyer because they brought up an argument that was a pure one. They said that the federal government had violated Bond's 10th Amendment rights. Why? Because even though she was not on federal property, because she filed the appeal and it was decided, so the petitioner Carol filed October 2012, okay, and they didn't even take a year to respond to her, okay. Bonds did a constitutional challenge. She argued that her conduct, though reprehensible, was in all likelihood allowed to be heard in the state court, not the federal court. Before the federal government could sit up there and act, it had to give way to the state court, like they do in most other cases. But the state decided that they didn't want to prosecute. Bond is saying that that wasn't their decision. That was hers, because she had a right to have her case heard in state court. So the Supreme Court ruled that they violated her 10th Amendment rights.
Oh God, this is some idiot. Chief Justice Roberts shows off his best material.
Now I will give you, I will tell all of you. I was one of those people who followed the news, followed the law, and I was a William Rehnquist lackey. I was all on William Rehnquist's jock because the news made William Rehnquist out to look like he was some saint. And he wasn't. But he wasn't that bad. Under him, there was not a lot of violation of rights as there was in some other instances. However, with Roberts at the helm, and this was the problem, Roberts went from being a junior justice of the Supreme Court. No, he was never a junior justice. He went straight to chief judge. Hey, look at that chemical reaction. Okay, I have respect for Roberts. I gotta admit that because he surprised me. He's made a couple of decisions that were literally right on the money. His argument wasn't a legal argument by, you know, how the dumb judges and attorneys like to do that legal thing and they like to argue stupidity. Well, he didn't do that in a couple of decisions. He was right on the mark. But I want you to understand what happened regarding this. The Supreme Court batted down a long-awaited dispute over the 10th Amendment, treaty powers and international chemical weapons this morning in a 9-0 opinion in Bond versus United States. The appeal had been lurking as a potential blockbuster decision, and it was. It was, because they said that the government had violated her rights. Wait, look at this. It says, lifted directly out of the pages of the Real Housewives of Middle School Chemical Lab, okay? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry, but this was her friend. She was sleeping with her husband, okay? I know that you watch TV shows like the dumb scandals. Hey, can somebody take 5 steps back because you're getting too close? Tell them, Drew Hill! Steps. I don't know how much longer. That's Drew Hill, ladies and gentlemen. All right. Monday morning, the High Court ruled in a unanimous
exercise of
comic power that the federal government should never have been using an international chemical weapons treaty to prosecute a jealous wife in the first place. It wasn't, they weren't doing just that because remember they were charging her with international violation of the international treaty because they were stretching, okay? But that's not what the Ninth Circuit Court ruled. They didn't rule that they couldn't charge her with that. That was one of the facts, but they also said they violated her 10th Amendment rights. That was the point. And whoever wrote this stupid article didn't get it, but they got it at the beginning because they talked about it, a dispute over the 10th Amendment. But then they referred to treaty powers. The whole issue was the 10th Amendment. They violated the 10th Amendment right. The case was dismissed, sent to state court, for which she was tried, but I don't know whatever happened with that case. But what I do know is that Bond's appeal helped all of you out. Okay? Touching the heavens above, we were 5 steps, y'all. Ooh, yeah! All right. Now, let's get back to the 10th Amendment. The 10th Amendment is quite clear when it lets you know the simplistic things. Oh, this is the 9th. Sorry. Uh-oh, Article 1 Tribunals. Okay, let's do this. I didn't know this was here. Why you say goodbye? Article 3 Courts, also called Article 3 Tribunals, are the Supreme Court and the inferior courts of the United States established by Congress, which currently are the 13 United States Courts of Appeal, and the 91 United States District Courts, including the District
of Columbia and Puerto Rico,
but excluding the 3 other tribunal district courts, meaning the
International Court of Trades.
Okay, now, what are the other 3 tribunal courts? Well, you have Guam, and you have the Virgin Islands. Those are Article 4 courts. 5 steps! Okay. They constitute the judicial branch of the federal government. which are defined as Article 3, by Article 3 of the Constitution. Okay? Pursuant to Appointment Clause on Article 2, all members of Article 3 tribunals are appointed by the President and confirmed by the Senate, and they have life tenure. Okay? You need to know this. Under the Constitution, Congress has vested these courts with the jurisdiction to hear cases involving the Constitution and federal law and certain cases involving disputes of citizens between different states or countries. Article 3 includes provisions to protect the courts against influence by the other branches of government. Separation of powers. Judges may not have their salaries reduced during their tenure in office, and their appointment is for life, barring impeachment. The Supreme Court has ruled that Article 3 courts may render final judgment in cases involving life, liberty, and private property rights. Pay attention. Article 3 courts have this right. So when somebody is doing a foreclosure on you, like I said, ladies and gentlemen, I didn't go over this article previously. I just know what I know. Okay? The Article 3 courts have exclusive jurisdiction, with limited exceptions as expressed below. Let's talk about the expressions below. There were three wishes. I need to move this up. Okay, get out of here. No, I didn't want to do that. I didn't ask you for that. Get out of the way. Get out of the way. From eternity, y'all. Four steps past love. And three wishes. There were three wishes. Okay, let's find out what an Article 1 tribunal. Article 1 includes Article 1 courts, also called legislative courts, set up by Congress to review agency decisions. Military court martial appeals courts, auxiliary courts with judges appointed by Article 3 appeal court judges, or administrative agencies and administrative law judges. These are legislative courts. They are not Article 3. Article 1 judges do not enjoy the same protections as Article 3, their Article 3 counterparts. For example, these judges do not enjoy life tenure. Congress may reduce their salaries. Okay? We don't care about the controversy. Foxy Brown, Drew Hill. Foxy Brown. Nah, yeah. Gotta get up! Come on. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, sorry about that. That's Drew Hill and Foxy Brown using the theme from She's a Bad Mamma Jamma. Okay? Let's you guys know what's going on here. Oh, that's another thing that I have to look up later. This is what I gave you guys. You know what, Foxy? Ladies and gentlemen, I do not like Foxy Brown because she's a little dirty. So we're going to do A House Is Not a Home by Luther Vandross. Come on, Luther, get to the do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do so that we can get on with this video. Come on, one more time. All right, we won't let them do it the third and fourth time. Ladies and gentlemen, like I said, even if Congress could authorize the state court to hear a matter involving a non-judicial foreclosure act, and remember, all of this is, we got to do something right now, so y'all have to excuse me. All caps that. Sorry, because of it being written in a box, it creates another box, so I can't do all caps that. Yes, I can. Hold on. Gotta do it. All caps that. All caps that. All caps that. All caps that. both that. Okay, the Non-Judicial Foreclosure Act is, and you know what? Let's put the word federal. Nope, that didn't work. Now, what we're going to do with federal, we're going to put federal in front of each one of these because I put those here on purpose. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not going to be up on the net. This is me saving this for my own personal issues and helping people with their issues. So what I want you to pay attention to is the fact that I put each of these, see, the Federal Housing Act and, wait, what I said, the federal, no, we, I gotta get rid of federal from here because federal doesn't belong here. Federal belongs in the other spot. See, my mouse just hops all over the place. Now and then, y'all, now and then, I call your name. And then you know what happens? Suddenly, face appears. But it's not. It's just a what? On when what happens? And it ends. It ends, y'all. To pretend it's all, darling, have a heart. Told you. Don't let one mistake pull us apart. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the Federal Fair Debt Collections Practices Act, the Federal Housing Act, the Federal Mortgage Satisfaction Act, etc. all, it has no authority by the Constitution to violate the 9th and 10th Amendment rights of American citizens, i.e. the right to choose jurisdiction. Remember, the federal courts, well, I'll explain it in a second. The Supreme Court held in Bond. We're going to do Bond v. U.S., okay? Bond v. U.S., that the federal government had violated Bond's rights. Got to put Bond in capital. To live alone, turn his house into a home. I climb the stairs and turn the key. Oh, please be there. Still in love. You guys, he's still in love. Come on, Luther, tell him one more time. I said, still in love. 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 Come on, Luther. Gonna be in love with me. Now I want to know, because it's driving me crazy. Yeah, still in love. Got one more part and then I'm gonna get on finishing up the video. And I said, yeah, you gonna be in love with me, because it's driving me crazy. See, to think that my baby would be still in love with me. I just want to know, are you gonna be, say you're gonna be, are you gonna be, say you're gonna be, say you're gonna be, are you gonna be, say you're gonna be, are you gonna be, say you're gonna be? Well, sorry, I'm a music connoisseur. All right, let's get back to this. Had violated Bond's rights to have the matter heard before a state court. And in that decision, the Supreme Court made it quite clear that an American citizen had the right to choose jurisdiction. for it is a constitutional right. See, Bond versus U.S. Ladies and gentlemen, do you understand what I just did? I told them what the Supreme Court ruling actually did. It said Bond had the right to choose jurisdiction because it said the federal government had violated Bond's 10th Amendment right. What does the 10th Amendment say? That she has rights. The rights retained by the citizen and or the state. She had rights. A notice of removal or withdrawal from automatic referral. So we put reference from automatic referral, but we're going to put in Google notice of withdrawal from automatic referral. We belong together. And
girl, you know we belong together.
Really?
I have no time for you to be playing my heart like this.
You guys know the song. Boys to men. We belong together. And you know that I'm right.
And you know that I'm
How could you play with my... Come on now. Why do you play with my mind? Said we'd be forever. That's what you said. And you lied. You lied. Okay, let's look up the other one. Hold on. Love me and leave me and never say goodbye. When you can't sleep at night without holding you tight. All right. See, the district court has this thing called automatic referrals because they refer it to the bankruptcy court. If the bankruptcy court had exclusive jurisdiction, then the district court wouldn't have to refer the case to them in the first place. So I want you to pay attention. I want you to pay attention how you are given the right of consent.
What are you talking about? It doesn't say anything about consent.
That's because you're not paying attention. Okay, we did the Article 1 and Article 3 tribunals. We're going to come back to this because that's what you're going to add to your notice of removal. Now, believe me, we've had the courts argue this point. But again, I say I have never taken the time to fully explain it like I'm doing now. Telling you where you get the right. Now, right now, most of you are catching up to me and you're trying to understand exactly what I'm talking about. So let me take you there. Your first time, baby, I forgive you. Maybe you'll try. Okay. The statutes governing bankruptcy court jurisdiction and authority that such matters are virtually exclusive province of bankruptcy judges. Let's see. It says the Supreme Court clarifies the scope of bankruptcy court authority. That's because I promise you nobody has brought the argument this way. And that's why I'm bringing the argument this way. Let me go. I said notice, we need to do withdrawal, not notice. You see how it has mental health tribunals? Nobody cares about no mental health tribunals. We want to do automatic referral. Withdrawal of automatic referral. Ladies and gentlemen, when something is withdrawn, does that not have the same reference as remove? Let's see, withdrawal, after withdrawal, automatic referral to, okay, I don't want to read that article, I just want, no, I need withdrawal of automatic referral, waiver of, or withdrawal, no, that's not it, baby, I forgive you, baby, maybe. Maybe you'll try. We should be happy together forever. You and I. come back. It's not here. Come back. Come back to love. Just come to my bed. Okay, order granting motion to withdraw from reference or setting trial date. Withdrawal of this court's automatic referral of this case. Order granting motion for withdrawal of reference. Okay? I don't want to do, in setting trial date, I don't want to do withdrawal of reference. I want to do withdrawal of automatic referral. Automatic referral, see? By what is called automatic referral of all such bankruptcy matters. Withdrawal of reference. Interesting. They call it the withdrawal of reference. That's the first time I have known it in case law, in court rulings, as a withdrawal of automatic referral. But they say withdrawal of reference by what is called automatic referral of all such bankruptcy matters. So let's see if we can go there. Now, see, Google used to do catch. Hey, there it is. It's there. No, I couldn't find it before on so many other browsers, so I'm glad that it's still there. Okay? But, ladies and gentlemen, there is this thing called automatic referrals where the district court automatically refers a bankruptcy case to bankruptcy court. The reason why I'm focusing on bankruptcy cases right now is because many of you are filing bankruptcy. And you are being trapped in bankruptcy because they're doing all kind of stupid things to you. They're robbing you blind. This is what I'm trying to get you to understand. If you did, and let's say you're in Chapter 13, and let's say you converted to a Chapter 7. Well, within 30 days of your converting to that Chapter 7, okay, withdrawal of the reference. So I need the automatic referral part. There it is right there. The authority of the bankruptcy court. Wait, no, don't want to do that because that'll take it out of the screen. I want you guys to be able to see. No, because it's still not the, see, it's still not the whole thing. I was trying to pull everything in the middle right here, like I'm doing now. Let's. She won't talk to me. The authority of the bankruptcy court to rule on all bankruptcy cases and proceedings, motions and advisory proceedings, are allowed by what is called automatic referral of all such bankruptcy matters from the district court under Article 28 U.S.C. 157. But remember, judicial body has no power to grant the congressional body anything. Remember, bankruptcy courts are congressional. Article 3 courts are judicial. The district court cannot do an automatic referral to the bankruptcy court because they don't have the jurisdiction to do so. This is accomplished by a general district court order directing automatic reference permitting all bankruptcy matters to be filed with the bankruptcy court. This is their standing order. A motion to withdraw the reference of a case or proceeding, if granted by the district court, would remove this reference in a particular matter described within the withdrawal motion. Ladies and gentlemen, told you I was correct. Would remove. Let's pay attention. I didn't write this. I told you you have a right to do it. And they, and you guys, some of you may not really even get what's going on here. Let me copy this first. This is the court's website. Do you guys not see what I just did here? I took you to their own site where they let you know that they recognize it as a withdrawal of removal. They recognize it as a removal. This is what they're doing to people because all of you are supposed to be stupid. Okay? All of you are supposed to be stupid and not know what you're doing. So this is for Pennsylvania. Let's see if we can do for Maryland. Let's see. PA. Let's see if I can. What's the abbreviation for Maryland, y'all? I know it's not my. Is it MD? I think it's MD. It's MD, ain't it, y'all? Yeah, it's MD. This is me having to think, and y'all know I can't think. Okay? So stop it. Let's put V. Now, what I have to do, because V, by doing Control V, it's going to put it in big letters. Okay, so the first thing I have to do is we're going to do this one. We're going to bring you to 10. This one, we're going to bring you to 3. No, we're going to bring you to 6. And we'll leave you, let's see, we'll bring you to 9. Uh-oh, I didn't mean to do that, y'all. That was a mistake. Mistake! Sorry. And we're going to bring everything else to 8. This is TLC. Y'all remember my girls at TLC? They done changed, y'all, a lot. But they still my girls now. Okay, we're going to, like I said, we're going to bring this to 8. So that it all fits on the page. Okay? It all fits. So now, we got our hand tool, and we save it. And while saving it, I'm going to go back to edit, because I need to take this word right here. Uh-oh. I need to do this edit. Ladies and gentlemen, as I told you, the gentleman who I was supposed to be doing his appeal and how he didn't get in contact with me and how he didn't keep our agreement, this is what the information I was going to be bringing up in his case, which would have helped all of you. But I can't do it now because, and I wanted to just send the motion in anyway, but no, we had an agreement. And all of the research and all the work that I've done, he was pulling me along by a string, and I didn't like that. And he'll say, no, he wasn't. He'll say, that's not the case, and I know better. Okay, by the way, a motion to withdraw is your choice, not their choice. But they say, look at this, if granted by the district court, the district court does not have the authority to grant it. They don't have the jurisdiction to do so. Why? Because you have a right to do a motion of withdrawal of the reference. Okay, what I do is withdrawal of automatic referral. Okay, because that's what it is called, automatic referral. See, by what is called the automatic referral. So I do withdrawal of automatic referral, not a reference, but automatic referral.
A court order directing automatic reference permitted all bankruptcy.
I don't want to withdraw the reference because they never have the authority to send it to the district, to the bankruptcy court, which is an Article 3 court. Do you guys understand the argument here? This is what gives you the right to do a notice of removal to federal district court in a bankruptcy case. But if you have a quote-unquote state case where you're dealing with the federal... Oh, no. Cancel. Whew. Oh, that's why, because it was a little too high. Okay, remember, the Non-Judicial Foreclosure Act is involved in every foreclosure. Every foreclosure involves the Non-Judicial Foreclosure Act. Even if it's a judicial state, it's included in the Non-Judicial Foreclosure Act. Go and read it. The FHA is included in the Non-Judicial Foreclosure Act. The Fair Debt Collections Practices Act is included in the Non-Judicial Foreclosure Act. And the Federal Mortgage Satisfaction Act is included in the Non-Judicial Foreclosure Act. These are the points that you must bring up to let them know that the federal courts have original jurisdiction because this involves federal law. And the state has no discretion, no jurisdiction, and they have no subject matter jurisdiction over federal statute or any law governing federal statute. So those of you who need to do a notice of removal, pay attention, because I've done several videos on this. This is just me backing it up, but pay attention to what I'm getting ready to do. Oh, wait a minute, hold on. Was that still the PA court? Yeah, that's still PA. I want Maryland. See, this is PA court. So I want Maryland. Because Maryland is the court I'm having the hardest time with. But I'm not going to be doing it in Maryland. But what I would do is I would find this same order. See, district court standing order, blah, 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 for Maryland. So, let's see. Yeah, I could look it up a different way. I'll look it up later. But ladies and gentlemen, what I need for you to do is watch this. I just need you to pay attention, because most of you, you won't get it. I did federal notice of removal motion sample. Let's get rid of the word federal because we don't need it. Yeah. We got Drew Hill in the background, y'all. Whoa. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Can we get one? And deceit. Lies and deceit, y'all. Uh-oh. You deserve. I can be your boyfriend. Look, let's do this. I got it better. What I did is I typed in standing order on automatic referral, Maryland. Okay.
Guidance on standing order.
No.
United States District Court, District of Maryland. Automatic termination of appearance. No standing order.
Oh, I said reference. I mean referral. It should be reference. Lady! Step one! The door! Step two!
Sorry. Well, I could just click here. But I put standing order and automatic removal. Let's do, this is not what I need. Let's do,
super small than what you've given me. You can't take no more.
Maryland has adopted the following standing orders, but I want the particular one on automatic referral. See, this thing talks about automatic stays, but I want the removal of automatic reference to bankruptcy court. No. Alright. I know that they have it because all the district courts have adopted an order, a quote-unquote
an automatic reference standing order. So this is the District Court of Maryland, which has adopted the following standing orders. So hopefully it's included in that list. We go here. Come to me! Now, notice of removal, motion sample.
If the case stated by the initial pleading is not removable, a notice of removal may be filed 30 days after receipt by a defendant. Through service or otherwise, a copy of the amended pleading.
Basically, you have to follow the rules. The rules are simple. Then what you do, you go here. Okay? This is a guide to removing a case.
And this is the same PDF that you want.
Sample pleading for removing a case to federal court. That's the other section you want to go to. Because notice of removal, federal court. Practical guide to notorogations through litigation. Okay? And it says notice of removal to federal court. But this is a sample pleading. So let's...
Debtors board. The debtors board.
Now, why would it be the debtors board? It appears to be referencing bankruptcy. Any love. You guys know about any love? In my heart, there's a need to shout. Shout. Dying and screaming, crying to let me out. That I want to try, that I want to touch, any love. Okay. Electronic bar member reactivation. I'm looking for amendment to local rules, certification of appeals, convictions, armed career 225, which is habeas corpus. Stealing breach of conference, motion, sentence, petition for registry, inmate, defendant, proposed order, prisoner cases, deposit, investment, no, state prisoner litigation, Title 11 proceedings. I know there's a love waiting for me. Come into my life. Hey. Okay, anyway, ladies and gentlemen, here is the motion. As soon as it pulls up, come on now, let me get there. Hey, I thought what's up? Get there. You know what you're taking all this time for? It's the debtorsboard.com. index.php ? Topic equals 2122.0. To shine. Ladies and gentlemen, here's the standing order. Okay. Pursuant to 28 blah blah blah, in any and all cases under Title 11 and any and all proceedings arising under Title 11 are arising in or related to a case under Title 11 are referred to the bankruptcy judges for this district. If the bankruptcy judge or district judge determines that entry of final order or judgment by a bankruptcy judge would not be consistent with Article 3 of the United States Constitution in a particular proceeding, referral under this order or determined to be a core matter, the bankruptcy judge shall, unless otherwise ordered by the district court, hear the proceeding and submit proposed finding of fact and conclusion of law to the district court. The district court will treat any ruling of the bankruptcy court as proposed finding of fact and conclusion of law in the event the district court concludes the bankruptcy judge could not have entered a final judgment or judgment consistent with Article 3 of the United States Constitution. Ladies and gentlemen, they already know a bankruptcy judge cannot enter a conclusion or final judgment consistent with Article 3 of the United States Constitution. That's the first thing. And this was done 2012. Pay attention to this so that you will understand what this judge just did. How he literally violates the Constitution. Violates the law. And what people need to do is start challenging this in their notice of removal the 28 U.S.C. Section 157A as unconstitutional because the district court cannot confer or refer any of its authority to the bankruptcy court, and the bankruptcy court determinations are not binding on U.S. citizens without their consent. Bankruptcy judge
or a district judge determines that the entry
of final judgment by a bankruptcy judge would not be consistent with Article 3 of the United States Constitution. It's not up to them to decide that. It's up to the Constitution to decide whether it's not consistent. So I would challenge the standing order. Remember, every court has a standing order. So include that standing order and say that the judge did not have the discretion at law to do this because 28 U.S.C. 157A is unconstitutional in that it violates an individual's 9th and 10th Amendment right. Okay? You have a 10th and 9th Amendment right to an Article 3 court. That is your argument, people. Every court has this standing order. But you notice I didn't find this under standing order. Where did I find this under? Does anybody remember? Huh? Nobody remembers? Nobody's paying attention? Oh, God. I've been in love a time or two, or a time of three, or a time of 15. But in the end, I still chose me! Me! Could ever make me feel that way. It's killing me. I found it under Title 11 proceedings. See, it wasn't under automatic referral or anything like that. It was under Title 11 proceedings. Every single federal district court has this. Okay? So, I'm going to close that because I don't need that anymore. Now, we're here. Sample pleading. Now, look at what they did for you, ladies and gentlemen. This is for the state of Maryland. I didn't ask for the state of Maryland. It just went.
Look, in specific, if you want to read statute 141, 146, 1446, 1441, and which gives you the right to run down, gives you the rundown on what is needed, the following is a sample. So, again, you go to those other sites to find out what the basic requirements are. You come to this site. And you do this.
Oh, yeah. I know that things aren't going right. But don't you think if it turns out right, love of God will happen every day. Losing it. Right now. It's a memory. Because we're not doing what? All right, ladies and gentlemen, sample pleading for removing a case. Let's see if they actually have it in Word format. Okay, because what I did is I copied the PDF. Oh, that's right. This is Opera. Opera is going to open the PDF here, and I don't need it to open the PDF here. Not a word to say. It don't even have to change. Nope, it didn't give me the document, so it's the copy and pasting. I dream of lovers past, and I sign a girl so that she lost the only she loved. He went away. And it's not too late for us to stay. Oh, by the way, you know what the courts have ruled? The courts have ruled that the banks operating on behalf of the beneficiary are not debt collectors. Do you know that, right? The courts have ruled that they're not debt collectors. So how do you handle that, people? Because I was just going over this section while I was doing Drew Hill. I was reading this while I was doing Drew Hill, okay? Because I can do more than one thing at a time, okay? So I was reading this, and it talked about the FDCPA. This whole section is about the FDCPA. But they have ruled that they are not, and this person is doing a notice of removal based on the FDCPA. Because it's a federal law. So here is a sample. So what did I do? I copied it. And I go, here, I'll open up all of these in a minute. Come on now.
Ever stay the same? Third times, I get a little lonely.
I'm gonna be there for you. No, I can't do it that way. No, ladies and gentlemen, don't do what I just did. Don't directly paste it because it'll come up like it is on the website. You have to paste it this way. You can do it this way. Okay? This one puts it in the same format. Okay? And this is basically a form that you just get to fill in the blanks. You get to fill in the information that applies to you and add the information that applies to you. But this person has already took the time to write up the notice of removal for you and provide it for you. Now, what this is right here. Because on motions, people put this. You don't need these, okay? You don't need these. It is not necessary. Sorry, there's another way. Tab, tab. Uh-oh, not that tab. Yeah, not trying to do that tab. So, we can't do a tab. We can do that, and there we go. Whew. Tevin Campbell again. Okay, I'm not going to straighten up all of this because I'm not going to use these. I don't use these. See, basically, this is what I do. We got this right here, and we're going to go open. I want you, those of you who's got Microsoft Office 2010, I was supposed to put a video up showing you where you can go and get a full copy of Microsoft Office 2010. Would you guys like for me to show you how you can get a copy of Microsoft Office 2010?
Yay!
Well, I can show you where to get a copy, okay? It's up to you whether or not you want to download that copy. We're going to do new. Call on me. You know what, Tevin? You, all right, but I don't want that. Who be this? Avant! This is Avant. Y'all know who Avant is? That's Avant. Okay, let's see. We're going to look for templates, and we're going to do legal.
L-E-G-A-L. Legal.
Enter. And we'll go about maybe 10 more minutes and then I'll have to stop because, like I said, I got a headache. Would you come on? Sorry, somebody's calling. So while it's doing that, you guys hold on, okay? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen and ladies, I left you on hold for a long time. And when I say a long time, I mean a long time. And while leaving you on hold, I just want to let y'all know we're going to continue with that song by Avant, but we're going to... Oh, no. I'm sorry. This song I don't like. This song is a little bit too much. Okay. Nope. Nah. These Are the Times by Drew Hill. We're going to play that. Okay. Now I do know this. Well, anyway, let's get back to reality. This is my opera opening up. I just upgraded my opera, got the latest version of opera. And so this is opera, and we're going to minimize opera because I'll get back to opera in a minute. Ladies and gentlemen, as you saw, I took this document right here, the body of it, which is basically the notice of removal. Okay, I copied it. I then, after copying it, opened up a Microsoft legal template that has the numbers on it, and I pasted.
You're just a pasty mother.
Okay, and I pasted it here. Now, this right here, in this particular form, these are okay. They are utilized. But that's what we're supposed to be doing. They're supposed to be all the way over there. Do you see? Uh-oh, get back. You see how they all line up? And if I go here and I hit tab, and I do that, how it all lines up. Notice a removal. This one, backwards. Uh-oh. Right there. And then I go over here. And I go tie up. That was not the tie up. I got to go back one. Tie up. Nope, still no tie up. Oh, I know what to do. Sorry, that's my fault. I'm supposed to be tabbing there. Okay. Anyway. Anywho. And all that other stuff. Let's do this. We don't have to rush at all. These are the times, y'all. Y'all know Drew Hill. These are the times. Okay. So much more. Do a thing at all. Take a time and talk. This is the way things need to be. No pressure from you and none from me. Put your hand on my shoulder. Okay. We go back right there. Uh-oh, right there. Now watch this. My heart gets weak. And I don't know you, girl. It makes it hard to speak. Alright, alright, alright. Now do you see? And then I do this. To see, baby. Shut up, Drew. Shut up, Hill. We're gonna save. We're gonna... Gotta let it jump. It's gonna jump a second. Hold on. Come on. To me now. There we go. See, gotta wait for that. Because it's gonna go in a different document folder. Put your head on my shoulder. And we don't... We're gonna eventually change from Maryland. But we're just gonna label this notice of removal. Okay? That's all it's going to be titled. Hey, it's saying notice of removal. I already have one. Uh-uh. We're going to do notice of... We're going to do sample. Okay. Sample notice of removal. Okay. Now pay attention. When I did this, I did exactly as I told you. I went here and I selected this one. Why? Because when I selected that one, it lined it up with the numbers. See, 16 is 16, 14 is 14. And now it's in a motion format. Now what you have to do is you're going to have to go through and you're going to have to correct stuff like that. Okay, and stuff like this, because that's what happens when you copy and paste from the internet. Okay, so it's up to you to edit your own document. And this is only 4 pages. You get to add all the, hey, Lenny Williams. His mama told him to leave you alone. Okay? His mama done said it, y'all. Now, you know if mama done said it, he ain't got no choice but to do what mama say. Because mama don't play. Okay? No, this is not lining up right. Okay? See, I'm supposed to be able to do... Well, I tell you what, I know what to do so that things line up the way, because I like to have my Roman numerals right there, indent, and we put the, see, that didn't do it either. There it is. Whew. Okay, now watch this. Notice a removal. Then with this one, I put the numeral 1. See, it ain't supposed to be doing that. It's supposed to... Wait, hold on. Let's do a tab. Let's go back, add my 1, my period, and it ain't doing it like it's supposed to. It's supposed to automatically indent. So, I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to leave it like that. Like that. That's what I want. And I saw the second paragraph moved over and I didn't want it to. It moved over too far. So what I want to do is I want to undo that move. He had low down blues, y'all. Hold on. Just making sure everything lines up. You see? Now it's got the one and two. That's why I wouldn't do the one and two. What we're going to do right now, pay attention. One, two, three, period. Oh, come on now. Let's do it that way. Yeah, it won't accept it. Oh, well. And then we're going to do this one as one. Uh-oh. Okay, eventually I will go back and correct all the numbers on it. And this will be five. This will be six. Uh-oh, can't do it that way.
Late in the midnight hour.
He was riding down the freeway, y'all. His favorite song. Sorry. That's Lenny Williams, y'all. And that's what he's known for is the See? Okay. This is the document. The way this individual did it. Okay. And so what I do with this one, we go... And if I messed up any of the numbers, I go back and I correct it. Ladies and gentlemen, this is how you would do your notice of removal. If you filed bankruptcy, what you're going to do is with the bankruptcy, you're going to take that bankruptcy, you're going to switch it to a Chapter 7. Even if it's already a Chapter 7, most of you are going to lose in bankruptcy. They're going to take what you have. They're going to take your house and everything else. This is my girl, Whitney Houston. You guys may not know this song by Whitney Houston because it didn't get a lot of airplay. But this is called Million Dollar Deal. Okay, in the last album that she did, Million Dollar Bill. And although they didn't give her the credit that she deserved for that album, in my opinion, I thought that album was very well done. You know, they're just mad and hating because she wasn't the same in later years as she was at the beginning of her career. Her voice wasn't the same, and they just didn't get it. But she can still sing. Okay?
Oh, oh!
Okay? She can still sing. So let's go. And I'm just showing you how I would edit the document, okay? You don't have to do what I do because you ain't required to do what I do. But this is how I would edit. 90 Sophia is supposed to be here. Okay. Uh-oh.
Oh, whoa, whoa.
Come on, Whitney. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the reason why you will convert your Chapter 7 to a Chapter 13 to a Chapter 7 is because they're going to take all you got in the first place. And you need to let's get rid of that, stupid idiot. Anyway, the reason why you're going to do that, it's because they're going to dismiss it anyway. The reason why you're going to convert it from a Chapter 13 to a Chapter 7 is to give you that 30-day window so that you can take that. Oh, and in bankruptcy, you're listed as a debtor. You're a defendant, and they don't tell you that you're a defendant. But the so-called trustee is suing you, okay? So this is a document that is, for the most part, done. And remember, people, this person who put this together, this person is old school. How do you know he's old school? Because he says in the United States Court for the District of Maryland. Then he says Northern Division. He's doing it the very same way that the court does it. But I do it the old school way. In and for the state. of California. Not, I don't want to do it for no district, y'all. Okay, but that's another story for another time. All right? Ladies and gentlemen, this video is just here to help some of you who are having mortgage issues, who are having foreclosure issues. The courts are not doing anything in your favor. They're violating every single clause, every single law. Remember, they're just administering a trust. So they really don't have any incentive to do what's right, unless you all start filing lawsuits against the judges. I just got finished having somebody send me a motion where a judge filed a lawsuit. A judge filed a lawsuit against her and the county recorder, trying to get a lien removed off of his property. And the person called me up asking me what to do. So I told the person, what you gonna do is something real simple. Well, what's she gonna do? She gonna do a countersuit against the judge. And he can't claim immunity because he's the one who brought the suit. That's how she's gonna do it. What happened is the house that they went and did an adverse possession on was owned by a judge. And the house had, I mean, literally, it was abandoned. You look at the house, it was horrible. They had to, there were so many weeds and stuff, they had to cut the tree down to get into the house. Ladies and gentlemen, every city has a ordinance which requires individuals to maintain their properties. From vermin, from debris, in case of fire hazard and health hazard. So they all have these health laws and health ordinances that require them to do that. So what they did is what they're supposed to do. I can't tell you how to do adverse possession because many of you would do it wrong. And there are so many different ways to do it. But they did. They went and they went into the property and they did some cleaning up of the property because the law in the state allows you to do that. Okay, this is what the banks get to do. That's why they get to take your property. But you have to place notice on the owner of the property. I'm not going to tell you how to do that because there's a simple way to do it. And there's a way that you can document it. Well, they did this. But the judge found out about it, found out about the lien, found out about the adverse possession, and decided to bring a suit against her for which he is presiding over the lawsuit. And he has since recused himself and filed the lawsuit. Why did he recuse himself? Because she did a, what's that thing she did? Oh, God. I got a headache and I'm tired. 2255, 2254, habeas corpus. She did a habeas corpus in the state and in the federal court, which put him in a position to recuse himself, which he did. When he recused himself, he went and filed a lawsuit against her. His job is he never served her a copy of the lawsuit. She went and got a copy of the lawsuit off the public record, for which they documented the lawsuit as being an unverified copy. Why? Because she had never been served. He filed this lawsuit against her while he was still presiding over the case in August. And there you go, your double jeopardy and your violation of the law, and you get him for ethics. Okay? But I told her that I wasn't not going to help her with her case. Okay? I was not going to help her with her case. I'm sorry. This is the last thing I'm going to talk about today, and then I'm going to let you guys... Well, I told her I wasn't going to help her with her case because she put herself in that position by not listening. Okay? By doing something without doing the research. Ladies and gentlemen, you get in trouble because you don't do research? Sorry. You're going to have to get yourself out of trouble. Do not call me. Do not ask me for my help. The same as I told her. Okay, the video I did on Saturday was in reference to her situation to give her some way of getting out of what she was going through. That's why I told her to walk into that courtroom and say, I'm the beneficial owner of the Equitable Trust. This was the same case where the new judge sat up there scratching his head because he did not know what to do. But because she entertained his questions, ladies and gentlemen, you're not on trial. You're not on the witness stand. You don't have to answer anybody's questions. I don't care if the judge makes it seem like he's extremely upset and all is about to break out. Okay? You do not have to answer the questions. The same as they don't answer your questions. So what you do is you take his question. Are you saying this is blah, blah, blah? You say, I'm sorry. You may have misunderstood me. I am the beneficial owner of the Equitable Trust. How may I help you, Mr. Trustee?
Well, blah, 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 blah.
Oh, I'm sorry. You must have misunderstood me. I apologize. What I was trying to say is I'm the beneficial owner of the Equitable Trust. And if he... Then you let him do whatever he says he's going to do. And you say once again, I apologize. I'm sorry if I've offended the court. But what I was trying to tell the court is that I am not participating in these proceedings any further, since you are acting in dishonor. I have nothing else left to say. I am exercising my right to remain silent. And you remain silent from that point on because there's no law requiring you to talk. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to say it again. There is no law requiring you to talk. You don't have to speak. If you don't participate, they can't go any further. So that's the advice I gave that person on video. But other than that, I will not entertain. I will not do a motion for her. I will not help her with a motion. And the person lied to me. Called me up yesterday asking me how much would I charge to do a motion. She said it was for her sister, only to send me a copy of that knowing it was for her. I don't like it, people. I just told somebody this morning. It is a universal rule. If you're faithful in what is the small stuff, you'll be faithful in the larger stuff. If you're unfaithful in the small stuff, you'll be unfaithful in the larger stuff. You can't get around that. That's a universal principle in law. It's a universal rule. You lie to me about something small means that you'll lie to me about something large. Okay? Guess what? This person lied to me. That means I can't trust her. I don't give up how she explains it. How she explains it away, that means I can't trust her, and everything is about trust. That's why when you hear me talk, you don't hear me lying to you guys. Because I have to be a man of my word. A man without his word is worthless. Ladies and gentlemen, lines 1, 2, and 3. Name, address, city, and state. That's what lines 1, 2, and 3 are for. Most people put it at the very bottom, but I'm from Cali, not from Maryland, so we do ours at the top. Why? Because that's your notifying the court of your address. That's your notifying the other party of your address. So nobody can't claim that they didn't receive this or that and didn't get this and get that. They gonna get it all right. Okay? Well, there you go, ladies and gentlemen. The final thing that I need to inform all of you. Some of you have been trying to contact me regarding consultation. Okay? And I've given you the proper way of consultation. If you don't know, you better go back and look at the title of the videos for how to contact me. Just that simple. I'm not going to keep repeating it. And we told all of you about SATCOM and the employment opportunity. Some people have been emailing me. Ladies and gentlemen, I specifically stated in the video about following instructions, following the directions, following the way that we've instructed you on contacting us regarding the employment opportunities. From this day, from this point, from this moment forward, anybody who contacts SATCOM or me through any other means other than what we prescribed in the video will automatically lose the opportunity. There will be no makeups. There will be no you're forgiven. There will be no, oh, it was an honest mistake. I don't want you to misunderstand me. If you can't follow the simple instructions, you won't be able to follow the larger instructions. He who is faithful in what is least will also be faithful in what is much. He who is unfaithful in what is least will be unfaithful in what is much. That is the golden rule. Okay? So that's just the way it is. Ladies and gentlemen and ladies and gents, have a very good day.